Let's now get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Lori De La Cruz. Good morning, Lori.
Good morning, ma'am, and to all our viewers and listeners. Right now, easterlies continues to prevail over the country and it's causing partly cloudy to cloudy skies with isolated rain showers or thunderstorms, mostly in the afternoon or evening. And at the moment, we're not monitoring any tropical cyclone inside the Philippine area of responsibility, and we don't have gale warning raised over any seaboards of the Philippine Archipelago. Meanwhile, for Metro Manila, the expected or forecasted heat index for today is up to 42 degrees Celsius. So our advice for the general public is to stay hydrated and avoid direct exposure from sunlight as much as possible. That's the latest from PAGASA. This is Lori De La Cruz.
Thank you for that update, Lori. China reiterates its claim Beijing and Manila had agreed on a new model in handling their maritime dispute in the South China Sea. The Chinese Foreign Ministry says the gentleman's agreement was reached with an aim of managing differences, avoiding conflict, and establishing mutual trust.
At the beginning of this year, China repeatedly negotiated with the Philippine Western Command through diplomatic channels to reach a new model for Ren'ai Reef, transportation and subsidy. The Philippine military has repeatedly confirmed that this new model has been approved by the entire command chain, including the Philippine Defense Minister, National Security Advisor, and others. The new model was abandoned by the Philippines after being implemented once on February 2. The remarks made by the Philippines cannot deny the objective fact that China and the Philippines have reached a gentleman's agreement on internal understanding and a new model.
The Philippines and China have had several confrontations in the West Philippine Sea, including another water cannon attack last week, which damaged a Philippine Coast Guard vessel. The National Security Council, not seeing the need to investigate the Philippine Armed Forces Western Command Chief following China's alleged deal with the unit. The NSC says China's claims are only meant to sow division among the Filipino people. The agency also coming to the defense of WESCOM Chief Vice Admiral Alberto Carlos, which it pointed out was among those injured when the Chinese Coast Guard attacked Manila's resupply vessel last March.
You know, Vice Admiral Carlos is a bemedaled member of the Philippine Navy. And kawawa naman siya at dinadawit siya dito sa mga insinuations, fake stories, and fake news and disinformation coming from the Chinese embassy. Kung si Vice Admiral Carlos entered into some sort of arrangement, bakit siya iwa-water cannon ng ganun?
At bakit nasugatan pa,
no? It doesn't, pag pinagdikit-dikit mo talaga yung storya, it unravels . So it's really it's really a tragedy na nadadawit yung pangalan ni Vice Admiral Carlos dito.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says the country's Coast Guard will not be equipped with water cannons to counter those used by the Chinese Coast Guard against Philippine ships. Michael Delizo reports.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. said the Philippines will not go the way of China in using water cannons in the West Philippine Sea, as it has no intention to further increase tensions there.
We will not follow the Chinese Coast Guard and the Chinese vessels down that road because it's simply it is not the mission of our Navy, our Coast Guard, to start or to increase tensions. Their mission is precisely the opposite, is to lower tensions.
Instead of retaliating, former Justice Antonio Carpio meanwhile urged Manila to bring the incident to the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Seas.
I agree that we should not respond by firing water cannon also. What we should do is go to an UNCLOS tribunal. If we engage in that kind of battle in the sea, we are outnumbered. China's the largest naval fleet in the world, the largest submarine force in the world. If you are the commander, you will not send your forces there only to be overwhelmed. You have to look for a venue where there is a level playing field.
Some lawmakers also support the president's position. Senator Francis Escudero said retaliation is a child's game and the country should not do what it believes is wrong. For Senator Francis Tolentino, it is responsible not to retaliate and maintain the moral high ground of the Philippines. Senator Jingoy Estrada also believes in diplomacy and peaceful means in addressing the issue. Security analyst Professor Chester Cabalsa says it is only right for the Philippines to abstain from employing water cannons and maintain professionalism as to not compromise the arbitral award.
May naipanalo tayong kaso noong 2016 kung saan naging bearer and champion tayo ng rules-based norms. Gusto natin ipakita na tayo ay sumusunod sa batas, tayo ay mas sibilisado.
But what will happen if the Philippines responds with water cannon?
Ito yung gagawin nilang dahilan para malegitimize yung conflict. Dahil sasabihin nila, gumaganti tayo or gumagamit din tayo ng dahas at ito yung paraan para magkaroon ng digmaan.
But Senator Coco Pimentel, who earlier floated the idea of retaliation, questioned the involvement of powerful nations, increase of EDCA sites, and acquisition of missiles and submarines if the Philippines' intention is to lower the tension. The Philippine Coast Guard's Jay Tariel admitted the PCG also feels provoked and wants a tit for tat.
Doblihin nyo pa ang galit nyo sa galit din namin. Gusto na rin namin silang i-water cannon. But we cannot do otherwise because we have to comply. And we know for a fact we trust our commander-in-chief.
The Department of Foreign Affairs is studying whether the water cannon attack last April 30 could be a basis for filing a fresh diplomatic protest. Manila has already filed 20 diplomatic protests against Beijing this year in a total of 153 so far under the Marcos administration. Michael Delizo, ABS-CBN News.
In other news, the Philippine president laughs off allegations that a supposed document of the Drug Enforcement Agency shows he was under investigation for illegal drug use. He gave no further comment after reporters asked him about the issue. But Executive Secretary Lucas Bersamin called the allegations contrived. A former drug enforcement agent told a Senate hearing last week he leaked authentic documents on the drug use of President Marcos Jr. and actress Maricel Soriano. But the Drug Enforcement Agency chief, Moro Virgilio Lazo, denies these files exist.
Kami ni...
Opo, noong 2012 daw po, Mr. President. Ayan na.
President Marcos promotes Filipino cuisine in a bid to lure more international tourists. He encouraged Filipino viewers of his vlog to amplify their favorite Filipino dishes and encourage foreigners to try local delicacies. The president believes Filipino dishes can attract more foreign tourists, especially after these were ranked the 33rd best tasting cuisine in the world by the online travel and food guide Taste Atlas.
Mayaman ang kultura natin pagdating sa pagkain at pagluluto. Ng mga OFW, ipasubok pa natin ang pagkain Pilipino sa ating mga kaibigan na iwan. Tapos ay imbitahin na natin dito sa atin sa Pilipinas. Nagdadala talaga ng turista ang pagkain. Food does not just feed the stomach. Ika nga, it also feeds the soul.
In the Middle East, where the militant group Hamas has accepted a ceasefire proposal in Gaza as an all-out Israeli assault on Rafah looms. The deal negotiated by Egypt and Qatar has multiple stages, starting with a limited hostage release and a partial Israeli troop pullback within Gaza. The U.S. says it is reviewing the response of Hamas with its allies. U.S. President Joe Biden also spoke to Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu in another attempt to stop the invasion of Rafah.
During the call, at the president's urging, Prime Minister Netanyahu agreed to ensure that the Kerem Shalom crossing is back open for humanitarian assistance for those in need. And I also want to take a moment to address the latest reports now out of Rafah, which was also a topic of discussion on the call. I'll reiterate again that we cannot and we will not speak for IDF operations. But we've made clear our views about operations in Rafah that could potentially put more than a million innocent people at greater risk. During his call with Prime Minister Netanyahu, the president again made this clear.
The militant group's acceptance of the ceasefire deal brings a faint glimmer of hope of reaching at least a pause in the seven-month war. Israel's war cabinet has unanimously decided to continue its operations in Rafah to advance the release of hostages, but it said it would send negotiators to Egypt to work on a deal. Israel's offensive in Gaza has killed more than 34,700 Palestinians. More than 80% of Gaza's 2.3 million population have been displaced, with hundreds of thousands on the brink of famine. Even if the ceasefire deal is still hanging in the balance, news of Hamas accepting the truce proposal was enough for Gazans to celebrate. Crowds gathered on the streets of Rafah Monday night to cheer the development, even as the fighting continues. Hamas's abrupt acceptance of the ceasefire deal came hours after Israel ordered an evacuation of some 100,000 Palestinians from Rafah, signaling an invasion was imminent. Over in Israel, protests erupt, calling on government to accept the deal.
We expect for the Israeli government to take this deal to save all the remaining hostages who are still alive. Save lives. Don't talk about fighting and blood.
We need every international intervention to help us. Urge Israel into doing the right thing. Urge the Israeli government to do the right thing and sign this hostage deal. The hostages have no more time. We cannot wait. This delaying tactics, Fitz Dragon, cannot continue even one day longer. We need them home now, and we need the Israeli government to do the right thing and agree to the hostage deal.
Arrests are made at another California campus as law enforcement officers clear a pro-Palestinian encampment stationed at UC San Diego for the past week. Police declared an unlawful assembly early Monday and ordered protesters to leave. After the warning, officers moved in and detained protesters who refused to leave the campsite. Meanwhile, over in New York, despite last week's removal of a protest encampment, Columbia University has decided to cancel its main graduation ceremony.
I think that it's a bit ridiculous considering that their entire justification for shutting down the encampment or everything else they've done on campus was so that they could hold a commencement or so they could hold graduation as normal. And then just to cancel it just feels ridiculous, and it feels like kind of a slap in the face to everyone involved. Like, no matter what side you're on, I think it just all feels like very futile that they did all of it.
I think it's kind of disingenuous and shows a lot of the bad faith negotiations that have been taking place. The university has been saying in a lot of the emails addressed to the students and the rest of the university community that the encampment and every other action that protesters were taking was the reason that they were threatening to cancel commencement, and the encampment has been cleared for a significant amount of time now, and they've made no moves on increasing the amount of preparations they have on campus.
The protests at Columbia inspired similar demonstrations at dozens of universities across the U.S. Students have called for a ceasefire in Gaza and demanded their schools divest from companies with ties to Israel. Chinese President Xi Jinping gives his support to idea of a global Olympic truce during the Paris Games. Xi also calling for an international peace conference in the future, recognized by Russia and Ukraine. China has not condemned the Russian invasion in Ukraine, but Xi insists, Beijing has been playing a positive role in trying to find a peaceful solution to the conflict. China has close ties to Russia, and there is hope in Elysee that Beijing can use its influence to change Moscow's position. Xi is on a state visit to France, with trade and international relations at the heart of discussions with French counterpart Emmanuel Macron. Now let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends. As a rundown, we begin with a judge threatening jail time for presumptive Republican presidential nominee Donald Trump for future gag order violations.
Justice Juan Merchan, the judge overseeing the historic criminal hush money trial of former U.S. President Donald Trump on Monday, fined Trump $1,000 and held him in contempt of court for a 10th time for violating a gag order. He also warned that any further violations could land Trump in jail. Merchan said the nine $1,000 fines he had imposed so far did not seem to be deterring Trump from violating the gag order, which prohibits him from making public comments about jurors, witnesses, and families of the judge and prosecutors if the statements meant to interfere with the case.
They've taken away my constitutional rights, so I'm not allowed to answer that question. This has never happened in this country before. It's a ridiculous thing. It's a ridiculous case. I did nothing wrong.
Last week, Merchan fined Trump $9,000 for 9 social media posts that he ruled had violated the gag order. New York law allows fines of up to $1,000 or jail time of up to 30 days for violating a court-imposed gag order.
In other news, Canada's Minister for Small Business, Richie Valdez, promised to move the Filipino Cultural Center project in British Columbia forward once Canada's 2024 budget is approved.
Valdez, who is also the country's Minister for Small Business, is excited about the federal government's plan to support the building of a Filipino Cultural Center in British Columbia. She says this is the result of the community bringing their request to her and to the representatives in Parliament, who in turn advocated for them in Ottawa. The proposed budget, which includes the federal commitment for the Filipino Cultural Center project, now has the support of the New Democratic Party. Valdez says once the budget is passed, they will take steps to ensure that the project's construction will move forward.
Next steps is more really making sure that we're working directly with both the Filipino community and with the provincial government to see what ways we can help move this work forward. It's working together that will ensure that this continues to happen and keep moving forward from here on out.
And finally, Finan designer Carlisle Nuera kicks off Asian Pacific American Heritage Month with a Christy Yamaguchi Barbie doll in honor of the trailblazing figure skater.
Barbie continues to make waves this month as it celebrates Asian Pacific American History Month. The newly released doll is a figure of skating icon Christy Yamaguchi, as its latest doll in the Inspiring Women series. Among the team behind the doll is Nuera, a lead designer for Barbie's signature at Mattel. Nuera designed many of the historic figures for Barbie's Inspiring Women line. He explains that the team did extensive research from Yamaguchi's performances in an effort to pull off one of her most iconic looks from the 1990s. Nuera, who designed the 2015 Mutyang Barbie, has recently teased that he will be releasing another Philippine-inspired Barbie in the future. He's currently being featured in the Phoenix Art Museum special exhibition, Barbie, a Cultural Icon, The Power of Pink.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFCnews, and head on over to the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok, back to our friends at The Rundown.